All right, so I'm Doug Rosenberg. I've been in this industry for really quite a long time. I go back to the early days of UML. In fact, I go back even before that. This is my ninth book on software and systems engineering. So I've been doing this for a while, and I decided to write this book because I've been teaching SysML, and it's been driving me crazy that the courses that I've been teaching pretty much ignore software, and I don't see how it's possible to ignore software when you're doing systems engineering. And the emergence of AI and its ability to write code is something that I thought would kind of reopen the conversation for systems engineers that are not necessarily comfortable with software and say, well, even though I don't know how to write code, maybe I can learn how to AI to write to, and then stop ignoring software in my systems engineering. So,
yeah, I have just one question about that. So for people watching, you know, who might be like, systems engineer, that sure sounds like someone who writes software to me. What is the kind of systems engineering that we're talking about here?
Well, so systems engineering really is going to include hardware as well as software. Okay. And a lot of the focus of systems engineering curriculum is in specifying hardware. Okay, so you want to start with requirements and start with use cases. You know, how's a system going to be used? And then what systems engineers are going to do is figure out what is the hardware of the system look like. Well, in 2024, pretty much any system that's going to get built is going to have a whole bunch of software. So people aren't building systems without software in them, but the systems engineering training hasn't really quite caught up to that. And it's because the people that are developing systems engineering processes and methodologies aren't necessarily software. And so, you know, nowadays, if you're building a system, it's going to have microcontrollers in it, and you're going to write microcontroller code to realize the behavior of that system. And, you know, for the last 4 or 5 years, I've been teaching SysML and ignoring this whole software component, right? And it's been driving me crazy. And it's been driving me crazy for like 10 or 15 years now, the engineering community. And so that's kind of the motivation behind this book, is to use the emergence of AI to kind of solve this problem.
Yeah, it's a really interesting approach and sort of use of AI. I mean, a lot of people have heard about AI being used for all kinds of things. And like, you know, again, as an outsider, it just seems to me kind of like the use that you're making of it seems like amazing and kind of natural. But I know that the arguments need to be made for it. And the example I believe you use when we're talking about a system in your book is of a scanning electron microscope.
And I picked the electron microscope because a couple of reasons. One, most people know what an electron microscope is, at least in general terms, right? Two is you can't really build an electron microscope without a bunch of software because it produces images. And those images have to be organized, cataloged, enhanced, annotated, right? So I wanted to illustrate all those aspects of the software part of the system in addition to the hardware part of the system. It's got very complex hardware in it too, right? There's motors, there's electron guns, there's all kinds of stuff in an electron microscope. So I thought it was a good example to kind of illustrate, you know, both the hardware and software aspects of the system.
It's a really fascinating too. Maybe Brian, you want to talk about this next subject, but about using AI as a subject matter expert when you're going through this process. So I imagine as a systems engineer, you know, I'm just imagining it's a little bit like a journalist, new project. I don't know, we have a lot of sort of domain expertise in this area, but you know about systems engineering and stuff like that. So how do you use AI as a subject matter expert?
Right, that's a great question. So what we did is a lot of prompting to where we asked it to tell us about this specific system of interest, which in this case was the scanning electron microscope. But you'd be surprised how many systems AI or large language models know about and in great detail. Now, that always comes with a level of engineering rigor that needs to be applied to ask whether or not what it's telling you is accurate. But I think that one of the most important things it can do for you is give you a great starting point, because that is a lot of times where engineers get hung up the most. You know, if they're coming into something new that they really know nothing about, which is actually very likely in certain cases, they might not know where to start. So it can really be a great amplifier in getting a big head start down that pathway. And then, of course, you're going to bring in your own subject matter experts to say, is this accurate? Does this really make sense? And is it what is telling us, you know, not a hallucination, for example? So that's how we use it. We did a lot of prompting, but we did this, you know, a lot of testing with the prompts that we had to say, you know, if we prompt them in these certain ways, if we set up custom GPTs, we can actually get a lot of great information back from this. And we're not required to necessarily even give it proprietary information. And that's a big concern in the industry, is how much information are we giving to these models that may be used by someone else? So we were able to ask it a lot of information without giving it much information at all. And that protected the proprietary aspects of it while also getting a lot of valuable information out of it.
That's really fascinating. One question I have for you, Doug, is a lot of people when they hear about AI, they think about jobs going away and being replaced. But it sounds like what you've done here is you found a way to unlock the power of AI to sort of enhance the power of systems engineers and sort of get them on board with projects a lot faster, and you know, have like it's a really great tool available for them to do better work.
Yeah, it's always anytime anything will. Any new level of automation gets introduced, there's always this big flurry of, oh my God, everyone's going to lose their job, right? And, you know, in some sense, I'm a little bit of a victim of that, because my company was building a code generator for about 3 or 4 years. And then ChatGPT came along, and suddenly this code generator we were building kind of got obsoleted, because, you know, we couldn't keep up with the pace of change. You know, you could think of, just for example, a user interface framework that we use, React.js. Okay. Well, there's new versions of React.js coming out all the time. And then within React.js, there's different strategies for managing user interface state, okay? And the state management, like Redux, right? That's getting updated all the time. And multiply that by, okay, now there's not just React, but there's Angular and there's Vue, and there are, you know, 15 different flavors of databases. And AI is able to keep up with the changes in these things much faster than we could do it with a template-based code generator. So we looked at it and said, well, that was fun, but I don't think we're going to be able to compete with this, right? And so it's something you have to figure out how to do when you run a company, is like, well, that's viable and that's no longer viable because the world just changed, right? So what I did is I said, well, let's teach AI how to do some of the nifty things that our code generator could do, you know, that were more advanced than just a plain vanilla code generator. Right. So, it's adapt or die. And that's particularly true in the AI era, is that things are changing really fast right now. Really, really fast. I mean, even during the course of writing this book, when we started it, you couldn't really upload a file into AI very easy. Okay. Like with ChatGPT 3, I mean, 3.5 was the one that really started catching fire. Well, you know, halfway through the book, Brian had upgraded to GPT-4 before I did. I was trying to keep the book, you know, freely available AI where that you'd have to buy a license for. Well, GPT-4 came out. It turned out you could upload a diagram into it. And then we had this one Zoom call halfway through writing, and we were pretty much we produced this state machine or some part of the electron microscope. And we're about to sign off the call. I said, hey, Brian, why don't you just drop this diagram on there and ask it to write the C++ code for the microcontroller? And he did, and it started writing the code. And we looked at each other and said, you know, it looks pretty good. And so from that point, the book changed. But even, and we wrote this book really fast. It took 9 months, okay, which is a very short time for writing a book. I've written a lot of them, and they usually take a year and a half to 2 years, and you're fighting the schedule. Well, we did this one in 9 months. And during those 9 months, the state of the art in AI absolutely changed under our feet. So, you know, the book has a couple places in it. Says, well, we made a last-minute addition to the to the book here, because AI just got more capable. And, you know, AI a year from now is going to be way more capable than it is now. And in 3 years, the world will be unrecognizable, right? So, you know, we ran into AI hallucinations while we're writing the book, and AI forgetfulness and all kinds of other stuff. And, you know, one of the things that changed about AI while we were writing the book with this avail, this new capability of being able to upload diagrams into it, is that AI used to lose the context of the conversation all the time. So chat sessions, ChatGPT were stateless. Okay. And because they were stateless, you know, it would always be forgetting, and you'd have to remind it all the time. And so we got into a working style of saving off a document, either a diagram or a Word document or something like that. And then at the beginning of the next chat session, we'd say, well, here's where we were last time. Let's pick up from here. And it would just say, oh, thank you for the context. Let's go. Right. And it just, that problem went away. So AI is getting way more capable. And so, what I think won't change is that there still needs to be a human responsible.
Definitely. And especially when you're dealing with, you know, big complex systems like, you know, scanning electron microscopes and stuff like that, or things in fact which can be used in healthcare and things like that. And there's, you know, defense and all kinds of things that are going to be touched by this. And as you say, adapt or die, and your new book, AI Assisted MBSE with SysML, is a really great book for people in your field to use to adapt to this changing situation. So thank you very much for being on this Leanpub launch video for your book. And keep me updated with any videos that you make yourselves.
Thanks a lot, Len. We really appreciate it.
Thanks.
We just found that Brian never got a chance to introduce himself. So
sure. Well, why don't you take a chance to introduce yourself, then, Brian?
Sure, absolutely. So I'm Brian Moberley with STC and Arc Field Company, and it started out as strategic technology consulting, but now it is owned by an umbrella company. And, you know, I worked with Doug a bit, and that's how we got together on this book. And, you know, we had a lot of chatting that led up to this. And we said, you know, we need to really lay down a firm foundation for people, aside from AI, to say, how do you step through a system modeling process? And that's what this book really adds in. That complements the AI is a great MBSE process. So the AI portion of that really simply accelerates that. But that's what is behind a lot of this, is a great process that you can follow and say, how do we develop a system, whether it has different types of software involved and hardware as well? And that's what this book really lays out. So happy to be, you know, one of the names on the book for the author. And I think this is going to make a big impact in the community. So thanks a lot.
Thanks very much.
Yeah, our third author, Tim, is, I think, on a kayak somewhere off the coast right now. So
I was wondering about that. I've corresponded with Tim over the years for some of his Leanpub projects and stuff like that. And he always gives very great, very detailed feedback. And so I wanted to get a chance to thank him on the video, but maybe someday. So thanks very much, guys, for doing this video.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Hi, you're welcome. Thank you.